Attention for a few minutes. Welcome to Shakespeare in the Park's 2008 production of Serendipity, and we're going to take you through a journey through the park to see some of Shakespeare's characters and his stories, some of which you may or may not know. Now, in each of the scenes, some of the spaces are actually quite small. So in order for you to enjoy each scene, we need to allow you to squish up together. You need to abandon your personal sense of space. Now, we're going to practice that now. Now, I would like to ask you, I know you're all strangers towards one another, but you're going to have to squish up nice and tightly together. So we're going to practice that now. Are there any questions? Good listening. Alright. Well, we're going to come hither. You're going to follow me, and we're going to start our journey through the park. I hope you enjoy it.
And with delights abound, and with delights abound. La 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 la. What joyful summer lasteth, each thing of pleasure tasteth. And with delights abound, and with delights abound. La 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 la. The birds so sweetly singing, the flowers so freshly springing, with nature's beauty crowned, with nature's beauty crowned. The birds so sweetly singing, the flowers so freshly springing, with nature's beauty crowned, with
oh, for a muse of fire, that would ascend the brightest heaven of invention. A kingdom for a stage, princes to act, and monarchs to behold this swelling scene. But pardon, and gentles all, the flat unraised spirit standeth there on this unworthy scaffold to bring forth so great an object. Can these gardens hold the vasty fields of France? Or may we cram within these wooden trees the very cast that did affright the air at Agincourt? Oh, pardon, since a crooked figure may attest in little place a million, and let us ciphers to this great account on your imaginary forces work. Suppose within the girdle of these trees are now exist some playful interludes. Piece out our imperfections with your thoughts, and into a thousand parts divide on man, and make imaginary puissance. Think, when we talk of horses, that you see them printing their proud hooves at the receiving earth. For 'tis your thoughts that must deck our kings, carry them here and there, jumping over times, turning the accomplishments of many years into an hourglass for the witch supply. Admit me, chorus, to these many stories, who prologue-like your humble patience pray, gently to hear, kindly to judge, our play. I know a bank where the wild thyme blows, where oxlips and the nodding violets grow. There sleeps Titania sometime of the night, lulled in these flowers with dances and the light. Follow me hither and see it for yourselves, the fairy queen, her kingdom, sprites and elves. Wander you?
Over hill, over dale,
thorough a bush, thorough a briar,
over park, over pale,
thorough a flood, thorough a fire.
We do wander everywhere,
swifter than the moon's sphere,
and we serve the fairy queen
to dew her orbs upon the green.
The cowslips tall, her pensioners thee,
and their gold coat spots you see.
Those be rubies, fairy favours,
and those freckles live their savours.
We must go to seek some dewdrops here,
and hang a pearl in every cowslip's ear.
Farewell, other spirits, I'll be gone.
Our queen and all our elves come here anon.
Come, let us hence. We are invisible, and will overhear the conference.
Come now, a roundel and a fairy song. Then, for the third part of a minute hence, some kill cankers in the musk rosebuds, some war with weary mice for their leathern wings to make my small elves' coats, and some keep back the clamorous owl that nightly hoots and wanders at our quaint spirits. Sing me now to sleep, and then to your offices, and let me rest.
You spotted snake with double tongue,
thorny hedgehogs be not seen,
newts and blind worms do no wrong,
come not near our fairy queen.
Fill no man with melody, sing in our sweet
never harm, nor spell, nor charm. Come near our lovely lady nigh.
And so good night with lullaby.
Weaving spiders, come not near. Hence, lonely spinners hence.
Beetles black, approach not near. Worm nor snail, do no offence.
Hence away, now all is well. One aloof stands sentinel.
Statues overturn, and broils root out the work of masonry. The brave will strive and fight for freedom lost, and rally to the trumpet's beckoning cry. They go to gain a little patch of ground that hath in it no profit but the name. Here Joan of Arc, Orleans' lovely maid, did with her sword fight valiantly for France. We see her now as England's spoils of war, a soldier caught, condemned, and soon to die.
First, let me tell you whom you have condemned. Not me, begotten of a shepherd swain, but issued from progeny of kings, virtuous and holy, chosen from above by inspiration of celestial grace to work exceeding miracles upon this earth. I never had do with wicked spirits, but you that are polluted with your lusts, stained with the guiltless blood of innocence, corrupt and tainted with 1,000 vices. Because you want the grace that others have, you judge it straight a thing impossible to compass wonders but by help of devils. No, misconceived! Joan of Arc hath been a virgin from her tender infancy, chaste and immaculate in very thought, whose maiden blood, thus rigorously effused, will cry for vengeance at the gates of heaven!
In peace, there's nothing so much becomes a man as modest stillness and humility. But when the blast of war blows in our ears, then imitate the action of the tiger, stiffen the sinews, summon up the blood, disguise fair nature with hard-favored rage.
Come, bustle, bustle, caparison my horse. Call up Lord Stanley, bid him bring his power. I will lead forth my soldiers to the plain, and thus my battle shall be ordered. Go, gentlemen, every man to his charge. Let not our babbling dreams affright our souls. For conscience is but a word that cowards use, devised at first to keep the strong in awe. Our strong arms be our conscience, swords our law. Hark! I hear their drum. Fight, gentlemen of England! Fight, bold yeomen! Draw, archers, draw your arrow to the head. Spur your proud horses hard and ride in blood. Amaze the welkin with your broken staves. March on, join in bravely. Let us to it pell-mell. If not to heaven, then hand in hand to hell.
In Roman times, the cause of war was just. To rid itself of tyranny, a must. Against fierce and powerful waves of greed and hate, even Julius Caesar could not escape his fate.
Oh, pardon me, the bleeding piece of earth, that I am meek and gentle with these butchers. Thou art the ruins of the noblest man that ever lived in the tide of times. Woe to the hand that shed this costly blood. Over thy wounds now do I prophesy, which, like dumb mouths do ope their ruby lips and beg the voice and utterance of my tongue. A curse shall light upon the limbs of men. Domestic fury and fierce civil strife shall cumber all the parts of Italy. Blood and destruction shall be so in use, and dreadful objects so familiar, that mothers shall but smile when they behold their infants quartered with the hands of war. All pity choked with custom of fell deeds, and Caesar's spirit, ranging for revenge with Ate by his side, come hot from hell, shall in these confines, and with a monarch's voice, cry havoc, and let slip the dogs of war. That this foul deed shall smell above the earth with carrion men, groaning for burial.
There are few die well that die in battle, and in the seat of peace tumultuous war shall kin with kin and kind with kind confound. Disorder, horror, fear and mutiny shall here inhabit. There on the war-torn plains of Tewkesbury, note Queen Margaret's lamentations for her son. Prince Edward's life by Gloucester's hand was ta'en. A war crime or a tragic family shame?
Ned! Oh, sweet Ned! Speak to thy mother, boy! Canst thou not speak? Oh, traitors! Murderers! They that stabbed Caesar shed no blood at all! Did not offend, nor were not worthy blame, if this were by to equal it. He was a man. This, in respect, a child. And men dare spend their fury on a child. What's worse than murderer, that I may name it? No, oh no, and my heart may burst, and if I speak. And I will speak. So as my heart may burst. Butchers, villains, bloody cannibals. How sweet a plant of you untimely cropped. You have no children, butchers. For if you had, the thought of them would have stirred up remorse. But if you ever chance to have a child, look in his youth. To have him so cut off as deathman, you have rid this sweet young prince.
Of carnal, bloody, and unnatural acts, of accidental judgments, casual slaughters, of deaths put on by cunning and forced cause, we'll soon hear more. Come, gentles, move we forth.
Join with us.
Macbeth.
The west yet glimmers with some streaks of light, now spurs the lated traveller apace to gain the timely inn, and near approaches the subject of our watch.
Tis he, the rest that are within the note of expectation already are in the court.
Stand to it.
Didn't be right, did I?
Let it come down.
Ah, treachery!
Way.
There's but one down, the sun is fled.
We have lost best half of our affair. Well, let's away and say how much is done.
May God have mercy on his troubled soul. But rest he will not while Macbeth still lives.
Hmm.
it was very sweet. And I'll just pop through here a moment. I'll contract me time. We thought there was nothing, mate. What? Is she to be buried in Christian burial that willfully seeks her own salvation?
I tell thee she is. And therefore lay her grave straight. The crowner has sat on her and finds it a Christian burial.
Well, how can that be unless she drowned herself in her own defence?
Why, 'tis found so.
Oh, it must be say off end end, oh, it cannot be else. Here lies the point. If I drown myself wittingly, that argues an act. And an act has three branches. It is to do, to act, and to perform. Argyle, she drowned herself wittingly. Give me leave. Look, here lies the water. Good. Here comes the man. Good. If the man goes to the water and drowns himself, he goes willy-nilly. Mark you that. But if the water come to the man and drowns him, he drowns not himself. Argyle, he who is not guilty of his own death shortens not his own life.
But is this law?
I marry, tis. It's Crowner's Quest law.
Well, you had the truth on it. If this had not been a gentlewoman, she should have been buried out of Christian burial.
Well, there thou sayest. The more pity that the great folk have countenance to in this world to hang and drown themselves, oh, more than they're even Christian. Right, come my spade. There are no ancient gentlemen, but ditchers, gardeners, and grave makers. They hold up Adam's profession.
Was he a gentleman?
Aye, he was the first that ever bore arms.
He had none.
Oh, art thou a heathen? Do you understand the scripture? The scripture said Adam digged. Could he dig without arms? I'll put another question to thee. If you cannot answer it to my purpose, confess thyself.
Go to.
What is it that builds stronger than a mason, a shipwright, or a carpenter?
The gallows maker. For that frame outlives a thousand tenants.
Oh, I like thy wit well. The gallows does well, but how well does it? It does well to those that do in. Oh, and thou dost ill to say the gallows is built stronger than the church. No, to it again. Come.
Who builds stronger than a mason, a shipwright, or a carpenter?
Aye, tell me that, unyoke.
Oh, marry, now I can tell.
Ah, well, cudgel thy brain no more. Thy dull ass will not mend its pace with beating. When you are next asked that question, say, the grave maker. Because the houses he makes last till doomsday. Yeah. Oh, get to thy work and tarry not. Oh, age with stealing steps has clawed me in his clutch and shipped me off into the land as if I'd never been so.
Has this fellow no feeling of business that he sings of grave making? Oh, that skull, that's got had a ton of the seen once. Oh, how the knave jolts into the ground as if it were Cain's jawbone that did the first murder. Why does he suffer this rude knave? Up about the sconce as if he was a buffalo. Oh, he will not tell him of this business. I will speak with the fellow. Whose grave is this, sir?
Mine, sir. And such a pit of clay to be made, if such a guest is meet.
I think it be thine indeed, for thou liest in it.
Well, thou lie out on it, turn. It's not yours, and for my part, I do not lie in it.
Ah,
yet it is mine.
Thou dost lie in it to be in the state of thine. Tis for the dead, not for the quick, therefore thou liest.
Ah, that was a quick lie, sir. Twill again from me to you.
Now, what man dost thou dig it for?
Oh, no man.
What woman, then?
Oh, none neither.
Who's to be buried in it?
One. There was a woman. But bless her soul, she's dead.
How absolute the name. How long hast thou been a grave maker?
Oh, I've been sexton here. Oh, man and boy. Oh, it's 30 year.
How long will a man lie in the earth ere he rot?
Oh, in faith, if he be not rotten before he die, we get lots of pocky corpses nowadays. They'll scarce take the laying in. He'll last you 8 year or 9 year. A tenner will last you 9 year.
Well, why he more than another?
Oh, well, his hide, you see, is so tanned with the profession. It keeps out a great deal of the water. And the water is a sore decay of your horse and dead body, sir. Well, look at this. You see this skull here? This skull has been in the earth 23 years.
Well, whose was it?
Oh, horse and man rogue, this one. Who do you think it was?
Well, up and down, I know not. I'm...
Oh, pestilence on this fella. Reporter, flagging a Rhenish on me. It was this same skull, sir, is Yorick's skull, the king's jester.
This?
Isn't that?
Wait, let me see. Alas, poor Yorick. I knew him, Horatio. Oh, a fellow of infinite jest, of most excellent fancy. Oh, he hath borne me on his back 1,000 times. And now how abhorred in my imagination it is, my gorge rises at it. Here, on those lips that I have kissed, I know not how old. Where be your gambols now, your jibes? Your dances, your flashes of merriment that were wont to set the table on a roar. Oh, not one now to mock your own grinning clutch, Ethel. Get you to my lady's chamber and tell her, let her paint an inch thick. To this favour she must come. Let her laugh at that.
Base uses we may return.
Good even, sir. We now must take our leave.
Aye.
To Elsinore the castle now we'll wend, to see what haunting ghosts can make of men.
First and last, a hearty welcome.
Thanks to your majesty.
Ourself will mingle with society and play the humble host. Our hostess shall keep her state, but in best time we will require her welcome.
Pronounce it for me, sir, to all our friends, for my heart speaks they are welcome.
See, they encounter thee with their heart's thanks. The table is full. Here I'll sit in the midst. Anon, we'll drink a measure, the table run. There's blood on my face.
Tis Banquo's land.
Ah, tis better thee without than he within. Is he dispatched?
My lord, his throat is cut. That I did for him.
Then thou art the best of the cutthroats. Yet he's good that did the like for Fleance. If thou didst it, thou art the nonpareil.
Most royal sir, Fleance escaped.
Then comes my fit again. But Banquo is safe.
Aye, my good lord. Deep in a ditch he lies, with 20 trenchant gashes on his head, the least of death to nature.
Thanks for that. There the grown serpent lies. The worm that's fled hath nature that will in time venom breed. No teeth for the present. Tomorrow we'll speak again.
My royal lord, he
you do not give the cheer. The feast is sold that is not often vouchered. While 'tis a making, 'tis given with welcome. To feed were best at home. From thence, the sauce to meat is ceremony. Meeting were bare without it.
Sweet remembrance, and now, good digestion wait on appetite, and health on both.
May it please your highness, sit.
Here had we the country's honour roofed, with a graced person of our Banquo present, whom I challenge for unkindness and pitiful misfortune.
His absence, sir, lays blame upon his promise. Pleased your highness to grace us with your royal company.
The table is full.
Here is a place reserved, sir.
Where?
Here, my lord. What is that moves your highness?
Which of you have done this?
What? Not my lord.
What?
Thou canst not say I did it. Never shake thy gory locks at me.
Gentlemen, rise. His highness is not well.
Sit! Worthy friends, my lord is often thus and hath been from his youth. Pray you keep seat. The fit is momentary. Upon a thought, he will again be well. Feed and regard him not. Are you a man?
I am the bold one that would dare look upon that which might appall the devil.
Oh, proper stuff. This is the very painting of your fear. This is the air-drawn dagger which you said led you to Duncan. Oh, these flaws and starts, impostors to true fear, would well become a woman's story at a winter's fire, authorised by her grandma. Shame itself. Why do you make such faces? When all's done, you look but on a stool.
Prithee, there, look, lo, behold, how say you? Why, what care I? If thou canst nod, speak! Charnel houses and our graves must seem those that we buried back. Our monuments shall become moors of the kites.
What? Quite unmannered and folly?
If I stand here, I saw him!
Fie for shame!
Blood hath been shed here. The old and timely human statute purged the gender, will I? And time since, murders have been performed too terrible for the human ear. The times have been when the brains were out, the man would die and there an end. But now they rise again with 20 mortal murders on their crowns and push us from their stools. This is more strange than such a murder is!
And worthy lord, your noble friends do lack you.
Do forget. Not muse at me, my most worthy friends. I have a strange infirmity, which is nothing to those that know me. Love, health, to all. Give wine. Wine! Filth! Bolt! I drink to the general joy of the table and to our dear friend Banquo, who we miss. Would he were here. And all to all.
Our duties and the pledge.
Avaunt! And quit my sight. Let the earth hide thee. Thy bones are marrowless, thy blood is cold. Thou cast no speculation in those eyes which thou dost glare with.
Think of this, good peers, but as a thing of custom. 'Tis no other, only it spoils the pleasure of the time.
What man, dear? I, dear! Approach thou like the rugged Russian bear, the armed rhinoceros, or the Horatian tiger. Take any form but that, and my firm nerves shall never tremble again. Or be alive again. And dare me to the desert with thy sword, and if trembling I inhabit, protest me the baby of a girl. Hurt! Horrible shadow. Unreal mockery! Hurt!
Why? So, being gone, I am man again. Sit you still!
You have displaced the mirth, broke the good meeting with most admired disorder.
Can such things be that overcome us like a summer's cloud without our special wonder? You make me strange even to the disposition that I owe when I think. You can regard such sights and keep the natural ruby of your cheeks. When mine are blanched with fear.
What sights, my lord?
No, I pray you, speak not. Question enrages him. He grows worse and worse. At once, good night. stand not upon the order of your going, but go at once.
Good night, and bitter health attend your majesty.
A kind good night to all.
Thus, with imagined wing, our swift scene flies in motion of no less celerity than that of thought. Come, gentle.
Would you thank you?
Was it so late, sir, ere you went to bed that you come so late?
Faith, sir, we were carousing till the second cock. And drink, sir, is a great provoker of three things.
What three things does drink especially provoke?
Marry, sir, nose painting, sleep, and urine. Lechery, sir, it provokes and unprovokes. It provokes the desire, but takes away the performance. Therefore, much drink may be said to be an equivocator with lechery. It makes and it mars him. It sets him on and takes him off. It persuades him and disheartens him. Makes him stand too. And not stand to. In conclusion, equivocates him in a sleep and given him the lie, leaves him.
I believe drink gave thee the lie last night.
Oh, that it did, sir, in the very front of me.
Thou wouldst drink the stale of horses and the gilded puddle that feasts. I have a very poor brain for drinking. I could well wish custom would invent some other form of entertainment. Oh, sir, you must away soon presently. There's a dozen soldiers on the shore for you.
Oh, aye. Right, all. Pay the musicians, sirrah. Farewell, hostess. Farewell, my sweet. You see, my pretty wenches, how the man of merits is sought after. The undeserver may sleep when the man of action is called on. I may see thee again ere I go, if I be not sent away post, my pretty wenches. Aye, farewell, mistress.
Farewell.
Farewell.
Off we go, all aboard now. Hop! And away!
Come now, go we to Denmark's distant land, where fair maid Ophelia, poor dear, so distract, divided from herself and half her wits, poor soul, her needs must be pitied. It is the poison of deep grief that springs all from her father's death. Her needs must be pitied.
Your true love know from another one, by his cockle hat and star and his sandal shoe.
How now, Ophelia? What imports this song?
Say you? Nay, pray you, mark. He is dead and gone, lady. He is dead and gone. At his head a grass green turf, at his heels a stone. White his shroud is the mountain snow, larded with sweet flowers, which be wept to the grave did go, with true love shown.
How do you, pretty lady?
Well, God ill you. They say the owl was a baker's daughter. Lord, we know what we are, but not what we may be. God be at your table.
Conceit upon her father.
Pray you, let's have no words of this. But when they ask you what it means, say you this. Tomorrow is St. Valentine's Day, all in the morning betime. And I am maid at your window to be your valentine. Then up he rose and donned his clothes and dupped the chamber door. Let in the maid, let out a maid, never departed more.
Dear maid, kind girl, sweet Ophelia. Oh, heavens, is it possible a young maid's wits could be as mortal as an old man's life? Nature is fine in love, and where 'tis fine, it sends some precious instance of itself after the thing it loves.
They bore him barefaced on the bier. Hey, no, 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 no. And in his grave rained many a tear. Fare you well, my dove. You must sing a down, and you call him a downer. Oh, how the wheel becomes it. It is the false steward that stole his master's daughter. There's Rosemary. That's for remembrance. Pray you, love, remember. And this pansies, that's for thoughts. There's fennel for you. And columbines. There's rue for you. friend. Here's some for me. We may call it Herb of Grace of Sundays. Oh, you must wear your rue with a difference. There's a daisy. I would give you some violets, but they withered all when my father died. They say he made a good end. For bonnie sweet Robin is all my joy.
Thought and affliction, passion and hell itself. She turns to favour and to prettiness.
And will he not come again? And will he not come again? No, no, he is dead. Gone to thy deathbed. He will never come again. His beard was as white as snow. All flaxen was his comb. Now he is gone, he is gone. And we cast away moan. God have mercy on his soul. I hope all will be well. We must be patient. I cannot choose but weep to think that they should lay him in the cold ground. My brother shall know of it. And so I thank you for your good counsel. Come, my coach! Good night, ladies! Good night, sweet ladies! Good night! Good night!
Linger your patience on, and we'll digest the abuse of distance. Suppose that now you stand on hallowed turf. A magic island now within your midst. You may, if time is right, hear Ariel sing. But look out for the monster Caliban. A freckled whelp, hag-born, not honoured with human shape. That Caliban, who now is kept in service, lights the fires, fetches in the wood, and serves in offices to profit us. Pray you, tread softly, that the blind mole may not hear a footfall. We are now near his cell. No tongue, all eyes, be silent.
Where the bass sucks, there suck I. In a cowslip's bell I lie. There I count when nails do rise. On the flat's back I do fly, after summer merrily. Merrily, merrily shall I live now, under the blossom that hangs on the bough. Come until these yellow sands, then take these hands. Curtsied when you haven't kissed the wild waves with the rosy trees we've hidden. And sweet sprites bear the burden. Hark, 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 hark.
Subject to a tyrant, a sorcerer, by his cunning
hath cheated me of this island. All the infections that the sun sucks up from bogs, fens, flats on Prosper Fall and make him by inch meal. A disease! I say, by sorcery he got this island. From me he got it. And if thy greatness will revenge upon him, for I know thou darest, thou shalt be lord of it, and I'll serve thee. Now, as I told thee, 'tis a custom with him, ith afternoon to sleep. There thou mayest brain him, having first seized his books, or with a log, batter his skull, or punch him with a stake, or cut his weasen with a knife. Remember first to possess his books, for without them he is but a sot as I am, nor hath not one spirit to command. They all do hate him as rootily as I.
What ho! Now if thou speak!
His spirits hear me, and I needs must curse.
What ho, Teleban!
There's one enough with thee!
Oh, come forth, I say! Come, thou tortoise! Win! Thou poisonous slave! Got by the devil himself upon thy wicked dam! Come forth!
As wicked too as my mother brush! With raven's feather from unwholesome fen, a drop on you all! A southwest blow on ye and blister you all over! This island's mine! By Sucarette, my mother, which thou takest from me. May all the charms of Sucarette, toads, beetles, bats, light on you!
Exceed hence!
You taught me language, and my profit on it is, I know how to curse. Pied ninny, scurvy patch, a plague upon the tyrant that I serve.
A devil! A born devil, on whose nature nurture can never stick. We'll no more hear thy ugly words of dread.
Come, gentles, let us leave this cursed place.
A clay-brained guts, a naughty-pated fool. Leave my island and don't return. You puce stocking, you maggot pie. You stuffed cloak bag of guts! Leave my island! You're not welcome here! Leave, you whoremasters! Leave me in peace!
Time marches on, and so do soldiers brave. With trepidation, battle lines are drawn. Fair England from destruction must be saved. And King Henry's men, to him, their lives are sworn. Against France's power, great England needs defending. Now Agincourt is where your journey's ending.
This day is called the Feast of Crispian. He who lives this day and comes safe home will stand a tiptoe when the day is named and rouse him at the name of Crispian. He who lives this day and sees old age will yearly on the vigil feast his neighbour and say, tomorrow is St. Crispian. Then will he strip his sleeve and show his scars and say, these wounds I had on Crispin's day. All men forget, yet all shall be forgot. But he'll remember with advantages the feats he did that day. Then shall our names, familiar to the tongue as household words, Harry the King, Bedford, Exeter, Warwick, Cambridge, Gloucester, be in their flowing cups freshly remembered. This story shall the wise man teach his son, and Crispin's Crispian shall ne'er go by from this day to the end of the world, but we in it shall be remembered. We few, we lucky few, we band of brothers, for he this day who sheds his blood with me shall be my brother. Be he ne'er so vile, this day will gentle his condition, and gentlemen in England and now abed shall think themselves accursed they were not here, and hold their manhoods cheap while any speak who fought with us upon St. Crispin's Day.
My sovereign lord, bestow thyself with speed. The French are bravely in their battle set, and will, with expedience, charge on us.
All things be ready, if our minds be so. You know your places, men. God be with you all.
God save the king. And now what rests but that we spend some time with dance and music, wassail, food and wine. Further on the banks you'll find favour, and sweetmeats good, and songs enough to savour. So on your patience evermore attending, joy wait on you, for here our play is ending.
Licht über den Rasen streicht.
up.
Trouble.